final matter to come before the court today is Deanna McGruski versus Daniel McGruski. Both sides will have 15 minutes to present oral argument. The appellant may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If you're the appellant and wish to reserve any time for rebuttal, if you let me know when you get started, I'm keeping the clock. I can keep you apprised of the passage of time. Court's read the briefs. We're ready to proceed when you are.
I would like to reserve 5 minutes. Good morning. My name is Jonathan Rosenbaum. Once again, it's my privilege to appear before you today on behalf of Dina McGruski. I'd like to start out by saying, in preparing for this argument, I've realized that Ohio Revised Code Section 310904 has nothing to do with this case. And any reference to that in my brief, other than trying to harmonize the interpretation of the terms in the statute, is probably irrelevant and misled you. I concede that this case should be controlled by Ohio Revised Code Section 310951, which has to do with parenting time, companionship, or visitation rights of a person who receives an order for active military service. The magistrate's opinion was authored under Ohio Revised Code Section 3105.051L, and so should this court's decision. Under that statute, by its express language, there are three possibilities only available to a court in considering a parent who receives an order for military service, for active military service, and applies to the court for a temporary order changing the parenting time under that section. The court, under 3109.05M1, A, B, and C, the three options are set forth. I believe the only two that have anything to do with this case are B and C. In B, a parent that applies who has received an order for active military service can require or obtain an order from the court making the other parent have the child reasonably available for parenting time with the parent when the parent is on leave from active military service. Or you can also get an order facilitating some kind of electronic contact while the parent is away on active military service. There is no provision whatsoever for the court to do what it did in this case, which was completely change the visitation schedule before the Serviceman McCruskey was deployed. In this case, they took what was 5 days a month and turned it into 46 days in 2 months. It took away my client's second half of her winter visitation. It greatly exceeded the bounds of the statute. I also argue that under the same statute, Statute 3105.051M2A, that the application for this relief must state, it says, shall include the date on which the active military service was to begin. That was never done in this case. With fact, to this day, we don't know. It's not in the record when Serviceman McCruskey's father was deployed or reported for active military service. It's unknown. I have raised this argument in my brief. Unfortunately, it's buried amongst attempts to harmonize and argue why 310904 applies, but it is there. I think it's a simple matter. The court had three options. It did not have the power to do what it did. It did not have jurisdiction to do what it did, but yet it did so. I also argue to the court that under 3109051M, the court is required to consider the factors set forth in Section D of that statute. The magistrate professed to follow the statute, the factors under 310904. However, they are very similar, and I really don't think that that caused any harm in this case, although it is a slight technical error. There's two statutes.
Attorney Rosenbaum, I don't mean to interrupt. Can I ask you a question?
Absolutely.
This was a temporary parenting time schedule,
yes,
wasn't it? How, what was the intended duration of a temporary pending time? How is this not moot at this point? And is it a final appeal board?
Well, one thing, it's not moot because the second half of this order, the magistrate ruled that any, during the entire duration of any leave during deployment he may take and is able to return, he gets every minute that the kid is back. And that's totally contrary to 3109051M, which says the only thing that can happen during that time is my client has to make the child reasonably available.
Is this child over 18 yet?
No. There's one daughter that is, but this child is not. And secondly, I deal with your question in the last part of my brief. This is an ongoing situation that's going to go on for a long time. Serviceman McCruskey, father, has never had any respect whatsoever, as I outlined, for my client's parenting time. The magistrate found a lot of that existed. He found them in contempt for that, although the purge for that contempt, which I submit was an abuse of discretion, is even though you've been found to violate the order one-third of the time, even though you've deprived mother of holidays, even though the mother gave you one extra day, you kept the kid for five, even though she showed up with the policeman to get her kid back and you refused to do it, the reward for that purge was you get 46 more days. I mean, if that's not the definition of an abuse of discretion, it would be hard, you'd be hard-pressed to envision what is. But returning back to one of the points I was trying to make, 3109051D, 10 and 13 are the factors that are relevant to this case. 10 deals with the parent's willingness to reschedule missed time and respect the other person's requested companionship. 13 deals, says whether the residential parent or one parent subject to the shared parenting decree is continuously and willfully denied the other the parenting time in accordance with the order of the court. Again, I submit to you that you cannot find a parent who has violated a court order more than the father in this case, yet he gets extended visitation contrary to the statute, and he gets to go on continuously acting in contempt of court without remedy. And this is going to do nothing but stoke the fire for the future. That's another reason why this case is not moot. Moot is a case is moot or an issue is moot if it only has no practical significance. This fight is going to go on, and my client is going to lose more and more visitation time until this child turns 18, because this father has never had to and never will respect the order of this court. And apparently the court is not going to enforce it against a soldier or a police officer.
What's the remedy your client is seeking?
For one, I'm asking this court to declare this order illegal. So if the father, serviceman, comes back on leave for the next month for holidays, then my client doesn't lose all of her visitation time. She's going to lose every minute she has with this kid the minute he gets leave and returns to Ohio. That is so contrary to the statute that it's an illegal order. It should be declared void. My client wants makeup time. She's missed 46 days, so some of it's holiday time that she should not have missed. She's entitled to have those days restored to her. That's the remedy we're asking. It's a void order. It's contrary to the express dictates of the statute, and it should be stricken. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel.
Good afternoon, Your Honors. Wayne Nickel on behalf of the appellee, Daniel McCruskey. I just want to address a couple of things. First of all, as the record reflects, there were two motions going on in this matter. The initial motion was filed by my client, and that motion was filed, as the record demonstrates, after efforts were made to obtain some sort of written agreement between the parties without having to resort to litigation to get an order. So he had his motion for additional time with the understanding that I have an upcoming deployment, and at the time that he filed his motion, I believe the record reflects, he did not know the exact date that he was going to be deployed. He did know, he did receive orders that there were going to be, the deployment was going to happen sometime in, I believe he thought late December, early January. I think it ended up being sometime in more towards the middle of January. But he knew it was upcoming. He had a son who he was exercising the standard order of visitation in Lorain County, which is basically every other weekend and one midweek. On paper, that was the court order. And then we had mother's motion, who filed, after father filed his motion, a motion to have father found in contempt for violating the court order that I just referenced. There was testimony, however, both from my client and mother, that the child was visiting with father much more than just the basic standard order. In fact, I believe mother testified that it was almost daily. I mean, these parties reside very close to each other. We have a child who is I don't remember which judge asked the question, but the child's going to be 17 in November. So at the time of this hearing, he was 16. And basically, you know, mother and father were operating under a very informal, hey, whenever you want to see him, that's going to happen. Father, being a police officer and soldier, as Mr. Rosenbaum points out, wanted a court order. He didn't want, for the interim, that mom could at one point, whenever she gets angry, we're not going to operate under this informal thing that we've had. So father wanted a court order, and that's what he did. He filed a motion so that he could have some certainty, so they could have a court order. Admittedly, by the time this matter got to hearing, we were really only talking about, I believe, maybe the months of October. I think the hearing was in November or October or September. September, the end of September. So we were talking about October, November, and December, 3 months, which, again, by the time of the hearing, that's what we were talking about. The intent of the duration, to answer that question, the court did address that. The court was very clear in its decision that this order was to apply upon return from deployment and release from active duty. The prior court order, the order I was just talking about, the standard order of visitation, from August 8th of 2014, to resume and to be in effect, and the temporary order shall expire. So the court did address the duration. It said, once he is released from active duty, the old order applies. It's very, very clear by the court. So they did address that. In terms of the remedy that was that mother is seeking, the court addressed that as well. The court indicated that father is going to be deployed overseas in the country of Jordan for a significant period of time, and that mother was going to have the child for that 100% of the time, for that time frame. So I think the court, in reaching its decision, reasoned and said, this is your compensatory time. Your compensatory time is you're going to have him 100% of the time because father is going to be in another country. He's not going to be able to exercise his regular visitation. So to give mother compensatory time, on top of the fact that how can you get more than 100% of the time, I guess, would be the inquiry. So the court, I think, properly addressed that fact by ordering what it did. And the court did find father in contempt, ordered father to follow the order that was provided, and then ordered attorney's fees. So there was a remedy that the court didn't ignore that there was a contempt file. The trial court issued an order, ordered him to pay attorney's fees, and father paid his attorney's fees. So I believe there is remedy. The remedy has been addressed by the court. I don't think it's a void order. Mr. Rosenbaum points out that it should have been analyzed under 3109.051. The trial court's decision is a little confusing. It makes reference to both statutes, but it does address 3109.04I2, that is the temporary order which the father petitioned the court for the temporary order, the statute. And I'll tell you, I represented Mr. McCruskey. There was no statute reference in the motion. There was an affidavit pursuant to local rule. The local rule in Lorain County is if you file a motion, you must have a statutory reference or an affidavit. We attached the affidavit, father basically coming to the court saying, I'd like more time with my son before I am deployed. And the court analyzed it under 3109.04 in addition to 3109.051. And again, my brief, I think, addresses some of the factors regarding 3109.04 I1. I think the father did provide mother with ample notice of his active military service. Again, there was testimony that he did not know for sure when it was going to happen. His history in the family of being deployed, and there was testimony to that effect as well, was that there was much stress and tension when the family learned that he was going to be deployed. So he held that information until he knew for sure that he was going to be going. He did not want to make anyone concerned, and he wanted, you know, it to be that information to be given at the appropriate time. So he did give mother ample notice of the
counsel.
Of
the it appears that the court is using deployment and active service interchangeably, those two terms. Is it your position that the statute uses them interchangeably and that they are essentially the same thing?
In Your Honor, I think that was at the objections hearing, I recall that being a big issue for the judge, as the active duty is nowhere defined in the revised code. So what defines active duty? Is active duty when you receive your orders, which we would argue that triggers the event. You've received your orders, you're going to be deployed at some point. So the active duty, I would argue, and the deployment shouldn't be really interchanged. Deployment, we would argue, would be the actual deployment, the actual removing yourself from the area, I suppose, pursuant to your orders. But the active duty, I think, starts once you receive your orders and triggers the ability to ask the court for a temporary order.
I guess the question would be, what did the trial court find?
I believe the trial court wrestled with it, and I believe they found that I don't think they addressed that, Your Honor, specifically.
Because the temporary order terminates after the active service. And this individual is in the National Guard?
Correct. And the active, well, I guess the active duty, I think I understand where you're going. I think being in the National Guard, maybe there's confusion as you're in the National Guard, you're always on active duty because on weekends and 2 weeks in the summer, you're on duty.
Or never on active duty until you're deployed would be the other argument, right?
Correct. So I think the nature of the statute, the idea of why would someone ask for a temporary order under 3109.04i for anything but actual visitation with their child or parenting time with their child. I think to say that it only starts, that only triggers when you're on active duty, and active duty being that it's deployed, would seem to contravene the idea of actually having time with your child, because yes, you can. You under 3109.051, as Mr. Rosenbaum indicates, you can ask for time, telephonic time, phone calls, things like that. But under the temporary order 3109.04i, that's the actual parenting time that you can have with your child. Why would you ask the court for a parenting time order when you're going to be overseas? You want the time to spend with your child when you're here, when you have the ability to be here, whether it be before you actually are deployed, or if you're back on leave. So that's why I think the trial court did go through and go through the appropriate analysis and coming up with the order that it did. The order wasn't specifically exactly what the father requested. The father requested much more time with the child. The order was what the court found to be in the child's best interest. And I think what shouldn't be missed here is we also requested an in-camera interview of the child. We don't have access to that. I don't know what was said during the course of that in-camera interview, but the court did make reference to speaking to this 16-year-old child about his wishes and concerns and coming and reaching the conclusion that it did and granting the order for parenting time that it did. So again, I think to sum up, I think the court did not abuse its discretion. I don't think the order that was issued was void at all, and I'd ask the court respectfully deny the appeal and make any other orders that are appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel.
All of these questions are answered by the statute and should not have even been considered. 3109.051M1, a parent who receives an order for active military service in the uniformed services and who is subject to a parenting time order may apply to the court for any of the following temporary orders for a period extending from the date of the parent's departure to the date of return. Under 3109.051M, when he's going to be deployed, when he's got his order, it makes no difference. There are three temporary orders that he can get once he's got his orders for active military service, and these orders can only pertain to when he leaves the parent's departure to the date of return. So that covers all of this, and we've been going round and round, and it's as much the fault as anybody for arguing these other statutes when the answer is right before us. This case should be about what does the statute say and what the decrees say, not what we want them to say, what's not logical, not what we desire. And the remedy that applies, that is available to this serviceman from the date of his departure to the date of his return, is an order that requires the mother to make him reasonably available whenever he's home on leave. That's it. He can't do what was done here. And we've all been pretty much chasing our own tails on this statutory-wise speaking. But that's what it is. It doesn't matter. And the order has to require, and the application has to contain, the date on which the active military service begins. So there can be no doubt about this. That's jurisdictional. It didn't happen. But we're asking that this court vacate this order because it is contrary to the express law. You can't have visitation 46 days prior to the guy's departure when the temporary order only applies from the time beginning on the date of departure to the date of return, but yet it was done here. And I also think it's a little disingenuous to say that this man did not want to trust his wife and wanted a firm court order when he, greater than probably anyone that's ever appeared before the Ninth District, has violated the court order he has. He's admitted that he doesn't take the kid back on time 30 to 35% of the time. He admits that if he gets an extra day and the wife gives it to him, the mother gives it to him, he keeps the kid for 5 days. He admits that she had to get an ex parte order, prying the kid out of his hands. It's a total disrespect. And to say that he commits these wrongs that by paying the attorney's fees makes up for it, demeans my client's position with their son. To say that here's $1,500 because you had the idea to drag me to court makes up for the lost time with a mother and a child, or any parent with a child, I think is not a good faith argument. This man, and to reward this kind of intentional, contemptuous conduct with requiring him to take the schedule that he wants and gets more time, I think is just absolutely the definition of an abuse of discretion. But courts are bound by the law, and litigants should be bound by decrees. And this man has never followed the decree. He gets, and despite that, my client gave him visitation almost every day, yet he comes to court saying he's not going to trust her to do that. I want more time with this kid, and I want it in violation of the law. That's just wrong. It should be vacated. Thank you.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement. We will issue a written decision, which will be mailed to both sides, as well as posted on the Ohio Supreme Court website. Thank you, gentlemen. We are adjourned.